So, Samuli is our speaker today. He joined u-blox in 2016. So, he's been with the company for 4 years, but he has 20 years of experience in the mobile telecom industry in various GNSS related positions at Nokia and Microsoft. He is a part of the product management team for u-blox GNSS timing product portfolio. He has a Master of Science degree in Electrical Engineering from Tampere University of Technology, and he holds over 20 patents in the field of GNSS receivers. So, quite an impressive background. We're very happy to have him with us today. And with this, I will leave the word over to Samuli.
Hey, thanks, Milena. Thanks for the kind introduction. Hey, good morning, good afternoon, everybody. This is Samuli speaking. So, as Milena said, so let's quickly start with the u-blox, the company introduction. Here you see our vision. We deliver leading wireless technology to reliably locate and connect people and devices. So this means location, GNSS receivers, and connection through cellular, Bluetooth, and Wi-Fi chips and modules. We are strongly convinced that the Internet of Things, the IoT, will change our lives, our businesses, our societies, and that is why we put a strong focus into that. We will also talk about the IoT from timing perspective later on today. On the next slide, we can see some numbers of the company. The revenue in 2018 was a little bit short of 400 million Swiss francs in USD, a little bit more around 400 million. Almost 7,000 customers served worldwide in three core markets. These are the automotive, the industrial, and the consumer markets. The company has over 1,000 employees, out of which 68% work in R&D. u-blox was founded in 1997 as a spin-off from the Technical University of Zurich. And then 10 years later, in 2007, it was listed in the Swiss Stock Exchange. We invest quite heavily on R&D. 19.1% of revenue in 2018 numbers was invested back into R&D. And the company has been growing steadily. The average annual growth rate of 2013 to 18 has been 12%. And on the next slide, we see our global presence, 28 locations on four different continents. We have sales offices and R&D centers in U.S., in Europe, in Asia, and in Australia. Okay, this concludes the very quick company introduction for those who might not yet be familiar with the u-blox as a company. Now, let's go to the topic of the day, the basics of GNSS timing. So let's start from the very basic. GNSS satellites. Each satellite has an atomic clock on board. Actually, they have several. Due to redundancy reasons, the atomic clocks are in quite harsh environment up in the orbit. Therefore, they have backup clocks as well. The satellites are extremely well synchronized to universal time. The universal time is the system time each GNSS operator has a master control station where they keep the system time, and this time is then distributed via the satellites. Now, the receiver itself, although it has relatively simple, low-cost crystal oscillator inside, by receiving the GNSS signals from the satellites, the receiver can take benefit of the atomic clocks on board the satellites and deliver the time within nanosecond level of accuracy. So basically, you get an atomic clock level of timing with quite simple a device with only a crystal oscillator, a TCX or VC TCX typically. And this, hold on, let's not jump yet here. This is then used to synchronize time between different kind of systems globally. So this is a global operation. Typical applications are cellular communication systems and all kinds of computer networks, for example. Okay, now the next slide. Okay, so what was mentioned in the previous slide, the global timing operation, this is what any GNSS receiver will do. But what is then the difference between a navigation receiver and a timing receiver? Why do we talk separately about the timing receivers? So here is first a navigation receiver, for example, like the car here, like the sat nav in your car. So for a navigation receiver, it does not know where it is, it does not know what time it is. So it has four unknowns that needs to be solved: the latitude, longitude, altitude, and then the time. So a navigation receiver always needs four satellite signals, basically four measurements, to solve the four unknowns. Of course, the more the better. If you have more than four satellites, then you can get a better accuracy, but at least the four is always needed. But if we look at the timing receiver on the next slide, we make two fundamental assumptions. We assume that the position is fixed, and we assume that the position is known. Thinking of typical timing applications, for example, here the base station, it is not supposed to move. It's a fixed device. And also we can safely assume that the coordinates are unknown. Therefore, the problem that the receiver needs to solve becomes very different than a navigation receiver. Now the latitude, longitude, altitude, they are no more unknowns. Rather, they can be treated as constants, known constants in the calculations inside the receiver. And the only unknown that remains to be solved is then the time. And this gives us quite few nice features, nice benefits compared to a navigation receiver. On the next page, we see firstly, of course, the time mode, the so-called overdetermined mode. So instead of using the four satellites for solving the four unknowns, the receiver can use all the four satellites just for time. So you have four times more signals, four times more measurements available just for averaging the time. I put averaging in quotes. It's not quite that simple, but you can think it like this. You can average the errors out of the four satellites to get a highly improved timing accuracy. Of course, you can, again, here if you have more, that's good, but at least it's four. But we can also flip this around. Instead of having four times more satellites, we can also go down to just one satellite. Since we have one unknown, it is enough to have one satellite, one measurement to solve this one unknown, the time. And this is called then single satellite timing. And this, of course, gives great benefits in challenging urban environments where you have high-rise buildings blocking the sky view. You have a very limited number of satellites visible at any given time, but you can still maintain the time output. Okay, then the next benefit is so-called TRAIM, Timing Receiver Autonomous Integrity Monitoring. So this is referring to the algorithms that are running inside the receiver, checking constantly the integrity, the validity of the measurements it's getting from the various satellites. Now, since we here assume that the coordinates of the receiver are fixed, this means we can do much more effective checking of the sanity of the signals from the satellites. In case of navigation receiver, there is always uncertainty whether the position is moved of the receiver or whether the satellite is somehow off from the others. But in case of a timing receiver, because of the fixed coordinates, we can much better calculate, estimate what is the expected measurement, and then have a narrow window outside of which if something falls, then we can clearly detect and exclude faulty signals, faulty measurements out of the solution, and therefore improve the reliability and the accuracy of the solution. And then the last one here on the slide is anti-spoofing. So spoofing refers to somebody who is transmitting a fake GNSS signal. He's transmitting a fake signal in attempt to make the receiver output a false location and false timing. An example here could be, for example, a Uber driver who wants to falsify his position to be, say, at the airport, so he could get a big good customer from there. Now if he drives with his car with his spoofer on and stops by this base station here, then also suddenly the base station starts to receive the satellite signals, the fake satellite signals pointing to the airport coordinates. But since we know that the base station is fixed, we know it is at these coordinates, not at the airport, this kind of spoofing, maybe unintentional spoofing, but spoofing still, they can be much easily detected in a timing mode in due to the fixed coordinates compared to a navigation receiver. Okay, so time mode gives us several nice benefits compared to a traditional normal this kind of navigation receiver. On the next slide, we then explain how do you enter the time mode. Basically, there are two ways. Firstly, if you already know the coordinates where your timing receiver's antenna is, maybe the location was surveyed during construction time, for example, then you can directly enter just the coordinates into the receiver. If you don't know the coordinates, then the receiver can automatically calculate, determine the coordinates for you. So in this case, you need to specify two parameters. Duration of the surveying, so how long you want the receiver to average the coordinates, and then what is the position accuracy you require. Once these are defined, the receiver will start the surveying. It will run in a normal 3D navigation mode, average the position until both conditions are met, until the duration is reached and until the estimated position accuracy is meeting the requirement. Then the receiver will stop the surveying. It will automatically switch to fixed position time mode, and it will start operating as a timing receiver then. Let's wait, one more thing I want to say on this slide. So in 2 weeks, as I said, we have the second part of the webinar, where my colleague Teemu will then go into more details. He will explain the messages, the commands used, for example, the surveying and the fixed coordinate modes. And he will also explain there are different ways you can configure the receiver upon the next boot ups. When the receiver is again powered up, you might want it to go directly to time mode, or maybe you want him to start the surveying every time you boot up. All these kind of things you can then configure, and Teemu will explain this in the second part of the webinar. Okay, Lena, then I think we have the first poll.
Thank you, Samuli, for giving this very interesting introduction into the topic. And we actually would like to just ask you a question. So I'm showing this one now. So if you, let's say, we would like to know, do you have a design ongoing, or do you plan to start a design during the next 6 months? So please select one of the following. I have a design ongoing. I'm planning to start a design during the next 6 months, or no, I do not plan to start a design during the next months. So I am giving you some time to answer this. I see the questions are coming in, or sorry, the answers are coming in. While you are answering this, I'd like to remind you about the Q&A session. In the end, please get your questions going. We already have some of them, but just throw them out there and we will answer them, hopefully. So I am closing the poll and let's look at the results. So we can actually see that some of you have a design ongoing and some of you do not plan to start in this next 6 months. So thanks a lot for participating in this. I am giving the word back to Samuli.
Okay, then a little bit of background, why we talk about GNSS timing, why we talk about it today, why is it a hot topic? And the answer is, of course, the biggest driver today is the 5G. And in the next slide, we see the triangle, the pyramid of the three corner stones of 3G. This is the image I have taken from the ITU document, IMT Vision. I'm sure many of you have already seen this, but let's recap anyways. So on the top, we have the enhanced mobile broadband. So this is basically the part of 5G, which brings you higher data rates, gigabyte speeds for mobile terminals. It allows you to do applications like replacing the cable with a wireless connection, maybe 3D video, ultra high density screens are mentioned here, this kind of application. And this is very much the area that the 5G rollouts we have seen so far are focusing. But let's not forget, this is not the full picture. I mean, there are two other cornerstones as well. On the bottom left-hand side, we have the massive machine-type communications. So this is the part of the 5G that is geared towards Internet of Things. Here they talk about the connection density of up to 1 million devices per square kilometer. So basically a world where every lamppost, every traffic light, every washing machine, every elevator, everything is connected to the Internet via the 5G connection. So massive amount of devices in a small condensed area. And then on the right hand bottom, there is the ultra reliability and low latency communications. So this is towards different kind of industrial application, autonomous vehicles, or self-driving car applications where the latency is critical. And also reliability is critical. Industry automation, robotics inside the factory, augmented reality. In augmented reality, if you start to have latency, the illusion quickly breaks. Now, all these three cornerstones together will then kind of be the full 5G once it comes up. And this leads to, on the next slide, we talk about network densification. So it's quite clear that not all these three cornerstones can be met with the network as they are built today. All this capacity, latency, number, a huge number of devices requires that there needs to be more cells than before, and the cells need to be smaller than before. It is simply impossible to serve a million of devices with these latencies, with these data rates, with the network architecture you have in 3G or 4G today. You might still have the big macro cells overlapping a larger area, but within that area, then you need to have a smaller cells, overlapping cells, provide the 5G service. And this leads then to a tighter synchronization requirement of the cells. This is mandatory to minimize the interference between the small overlapping cells and to optimize the spectrum usage. And another aspect of this densification, it will also mean that more and more often the conditions where the base stations will be are more challenging for GNSS reception. You cannot anymore assume that the GNSS antenna will be on the top of the cell tower. Rather, it might be in a lamppost or on the side of a building or inside a building, these kind of conditions. And this then means that the timeout again comes handy. It provides you more error budget. So even in more difficult conditions, you still maintain good timing output. Single satellite timing, which we already spoke earlier, of course, comes very handy in this kind of conditions where you have a limited sky view and you still maintain the time output. And multi-band and multi-GNSS receivers, they give you, they give you both improved availability and resilience because you have more satellites, more signals, so the better availability you have in difficult limited sky view conditions. Okay, then we go to the next slide. So what do the standards say? 3GPP requirements for the basic 5G is 1.5 microsecond time synchronization end to end. So basically this is the air interface requirement. This is the same as 3G and 4G. So not so bad, but 2 points here to keep in mind. So first of all, this is really the basic 5G. If you want to deliver the full 5G potential, all the three cornerstones, this will require much tighter sync. And also this is the end-to-end, so this is the air interface synchronization requirement. So within the network, you need to plan how the error budget is distributed over the various components you have in the network. Every switch, every router has its own contribution and you need to budget something for those. Okay, so very basic 5G is this, but then when we start to go to the full 5G promise kind of applications, there are new cooperative techniques that are designed in to deliver this. For example, the cooperative multipoint, carrier aggregation, massive MIMO. On the right hand side, I'm trying to illustrate the cooperative multipoint. In this case, you have several base stations simultaneously connected to one user device. This is needed to provide, for example, the massive data rates for the device. And in this picture, it's starting to get obvious that these base stations, if they are simultaneously talking to one device, they need to be very accurately synchronized with each other. Otherwise, they will just timing requirement here is down to 130 nanoseconds. And this is a local requirement. I have underlined here the local. So it is really the base stations that are close to each other that are serving the same devices that need to be accurately synchronized. And here you already see that the requirement goes down by an order of magnitude from 1.5 micro to 130 nanoseconds. And 5G will also bring new services, and the one that requires the most tight synchronization is the network-based positioning. Here it's quite straightforward to calculate the timing accuracy requirement just from the position accuracy you wish to achieve with this service. 10 nanosecond converts to a 3 meter position error, for example. Okay, so but this is 3GPP. So this is the air interface kind of end-to-end requirement. This does not say anything about the components that you use to build the network. On the next slide, then we talk about the ITU, the International Telecommunication Union. They define standards who give you the timing characteristics of primary reference clocks. So these are like the master clocks that you have on your network. And these are directly the requirements to these clocks, not an end-to-end requirement, but the requirement to the clock. And also here we see the same pattern. Every new generation, the synchronization requirement is getting tighter and tighter, starting from the 3 microseconds in G.811 in 1988. Going down to 300 nano, then 100 nano, and then the latest version, the G.8272.1, going down to 15 nanosecond. And on the picture on the right, I illustrate the maximum time interval error as specified by the different versions of the standard. And as you can see, it goes down on a logarithmic scale even. Okay. And with this, we can go to the next poll.
Thank you, Samuli. So it's time to get active again for you guys. We would like to know what is the potential of your project. So please select one which applies to you, 0 to 1,000 pieces, 1,000 to 5,000, or more than 5,000. So give you some moments to answer this, and happy to see that we got quite some questions coming in. So we're excited about the Q&A in just a bit. I see answers are coming in. We collect responses. I will also remind you that this webinar will be available on demand, so on our website, so meaning you can watch it at any time if you'd like to go back to something. There's always a chance to revisit the topic. So let's just close this and then let's look at what you guys have answered. So yeah, it's quite interesting. So 54% of you have 0 to 1,000, and then actually 27 have more than 5,000. So that's very interesting. Thanks a lot, guys, for participating. I will hand the word over to Samuli, and he will give you a deep dive into the u-blox GNSS timing portfolio.
Okay, thank you, Milena. So let's then look what is the u-blox portfolio, what are the products we have, what features, what benefits we offer to you as our customers. So here we have the products. On the left-hand side, we have the u-blox 8 generation, Neo MAT and Leo MAT. And then on the right-hand side, we have the latest u-blox 9 generation, ZF90 and the RCBF90 board. Now, all of these are obviously timing receivers. They are multi-GNSS timing receivers. The difference is that the u-blox 8 generation is a single band, whereas the latest u-blox 9 generation is a multi-band. And we talk a little bit later about the benefits from the multi-band, but immediately you can see here that the timing accuracy we have improved thanks to this multi-band technology from 20 nanosecond to 5 nanosecond, even going down to 2.5 nanosecond in differential timing mode. This one I will also briefly touch later. We have also reduced the time pulse jitter from plus minus 11 nanoseconds to 4. And all of these products come with a jitter reduction functionality to reduce it even further. And of course, they are timing receivers, so they provide you the 1 pulse per second time pulse outputs, actually 2 pieces of them. And these are not just 1 pulse per second, these are configurable. So you can set the frequency of the output anywhere between 0.25 Hz up to 10 MHz or even 25 MHz in case of the u-blox 9. since they are timing receivers, they obviously come with all the timing features we spoke about earlier, the surveying, the single satellite timing, the timing TRAM, the timing receiver integrity monitoring, and anti-jamming and anti-spoofing features are also included. Okay, so we say that u-blox 9 generation, the difference is the multiband, and why do we go here? So in the next slides, I will briefly show you what are the bands. So here we see the L1, L2, L5 bands. So these are the bands that the GNSS systems, the satellites are using for their transmission. L1 band on the right, the 1575 megahertz band. This is the legacy band where it all started. The first civilian GPS transmissions decades ago. And up to today, all the single band receivers are operating on this L1 band. And today you can get all the systems you have, GPS, Galileo, Baidu, and GLONASS signals in this band. But in the recent years, the systems have started to offer civilian signals also on the lower bands, on the L2 band at 1227 megahertz, and on the L5 band and 1176 megahertz. Transmissions have been here before, but they have been for a long time only military signals. But now we have also the civilian signals, and therefore it is possible now to offer these signals to also you, our customers. And in the next slide, we show the two options that we at u-blox provide. So we have the so-called band option A, which is available today. This gives you the full coverage of all the signals on the L1 band here. And also it covers the L2 band and even the upper part of the L5 band. So this is the option that provides you the largest number of satellites and signals that are available today. Later this year, we will also bring out the band option B. This still gives you the full L1 band, the same as the band option A. But in addition, we will then support the lower part of the L5 band, the so-called L5 signals, the GPS L5, the Baidu P2A, the Galileo E5A signals, or the global signals in this band. And if you scroll to the next slide, then we see the options that we offer. These offer you the highest number of supported constellations and the highest number of visible satellites. And of course, we do this because the more satellites you have, the better timing accuracy, the better availability in these difficult urban conditions, and better overall reliability you will have. Okay, then on the following slide, we speak about the benefits of the multiband. So I will give you two benefits why we decided to go to this multiband operation. The first one relates to the timing accuracy itself. So up to until now, ionosphere has been and is the biggest error source in GNSS timing. Ionosphere is a layer of the atmosphere where the radiation from the sun is strong enough to detach the electrons, the outer electrons from atoms and molecules. So therefore, in ionosphere, there is always free charge particles, ions floating, hence also the name ionosphere. And there's a so-called total electron content, which kind of is a characteristic of the ionosphere. These charged particles, these will affect the radio waves that are propagating through the ionosphere. As my simple picture here is trying to illustrate the line that the radio wave is traveling is somehow distorted when it goes through the ionosphere. And this, of course, means that the receiver will no longer measure the direct line of sight, the true distance, but rather something which has some error component added. And this also means that there is this error component added to the time output as well. Now, since this is the total electron content, the ionosphere conditions are dependent on the radiation of the sun. It means that the conditions are depending on the time of the day. You will have different amount of radiation from the sun during daytime and nighttime. So this causes daily variation to the ionosphere, and hence also daily variation to the time output that the receiver is providing. And the same applies for season, summertime, wintertime, you have different ionospheric conditions, and even the solar sunspot activity with a very long 11-year cycle will have an effect. But the good thing is that the effect that the ionosphere has is dependent on the frequency of the radio wave. So by using a multiband receiver, you will observe the ionosphere on two separate frequencies. And by doing this, you can actually mitigate the effects of the ionospheric variation. So what you get is a consistent and a reliable timing solution where the daily, the seasonal, the solar activity variation are mitigated. And all this is built inside the multiband receiver. There is no need for any external correction service, any external data, nothing like this. Now you might ask, so how big is this error? And is this really something that we should be worried about? So on the next page, we show you two tables that are taken from Galileo Service Center's webpage. And these are showing the different error sources for single band and the multiband receiver. And on the left-hand side table, you can see the residual ionosphere error is in order of 3 to 6 meters and is by far the biggest error source in the single band case. But when you look at the right-hand side, here we have the multiband receiver, the ionosphere error has gone down to 3 to 8 centimeters. And it's no longer a significant factor. The other error sources are already bigger. So clearly by using a multiband receiver, you get rid of the biggest error contributor. Here the errors are given in meters, but we can again convert this to time units. So 3 meters is 10 nanoseconds, 6 meters equals to 20 nanoseconds. So an error component of 10 to 20 nanoseconds can be removed by using the multiband techniques. Okay, this was the one benefit of the multipad. And on the next page, we talk about the second benefit, which is then the improved anti-jamming and anti-spoofing. So many of the jammers that are out there today are targeting the L1 band. For example, I just took from the internet some webshop, the device on the right. Lichter style car GPS jammer. Of course, these are illegal devices in many countries, but somehow they are still sold in the internet. But these kind of devices, they typically targeting the L1 band, simply because up to until now, the receivers have dominantly been L1 only receiver. Now the benefit of having a multiband GNSS receiver is then quite obvious. If somebody is using a device like this to knock out the L1 band, the multiband receiver can still continue operating on the second band. This is quite obvious. Okay, so these are the two main benefits from the multiband. You get rid of the ionospheric error to get better timing accuracy, and then you also at the same time get improved anti-jamming, anti-spoofing capabilities. Okay, and then I have on the next slide one more thing about the u-blox 9. Earlier we spoke about 5G timing requirements mainly being a local requirement. So here on the left hand side we have the kind of traditional typical timing receiver. The receivers are synchronized to the GNSS time or UTC time as transmitted by the satellite. This gives you a global operation. No matter where you are on the Earth, it will always be synchronized to the same time that is transmitted from the satellites. There's absolutely no need for any kind of communication between receivers. And with ZF90, you can get time accuracy down to 5 nanoseconds. Now, this is all good and this is all nice, but this is not really addressing the localness of the 5G requirement. So we thought, what could we do to improve this locally? And we came up with a differential timing mode, which is then on the right hand side. So here the setup is slightly different. Here we assign one of the receivers to act as a master device. Then the master device is generating corrections, and these corrections are then distributed to nearby other receivers that will use these corrections, and therefore they will get extremely well synchronized to the master's time. So this is a small difference, but it's good to notice that the slave devices are synchronized to the master's time, and the master is then synchronized to the time from the satellites. This you can do within a local area. We put here a 50 kilometer radius. And as long as the satellites that the master and the slaves are seeing, as long as the ionosphere that the master and slaves are seeing are similar, then the common errors are canceling out. This could be, for example, errors related to the satellite orbit, errors related to the satellite clock, any residual errors due to the atmosphere, which is still within a certain area, is still sufficiently similar to the master and slave devices. The downside here is that this will require then a communication link. Somehow you need to deliver the correction data from the master to the slaves. However, this is a one-way communication. This is a broadcast. There is no need for any communication back from the slave to the master. So it's broadcast only. And by doing this, you will get the best possible local time accuracy. So the local time accuracy that the 5G was specifically asking for the new features. With ZF90, we can go down to 2.5 nanoseconds. So we can still knock half of the error away. Okay, this was my last slide about the u-blox products. I think we have time then for the last poll.
Thank you, Samuli. Yes, one last poll before we jump into the Q&A. I want to make sure we have enough time. So after watching this webinar so far, would you say that yes, you would like to join the next technical webinar in around 2 weeks? So please let us know. And anyhow, please invite your interested peers, friends, colleagues. We will send you an invitation, of course, with the registration link. We'd just be interested to see if this is something which is of interest to you. And great result, guys. Happy to see that you like this so far. So we look forward to see you there in around 2 weeks. I will I'll hand over the word to Samuli for a short summary.
Okay, just a one-slider summary. So three things I hope you will remember for this webinar. So first of all, the benefits of timing receiver compared to a normal navigation receiver. So we assume the fixed coordinates, therefore we get the improved timing accuracy. We can do the single satellite timing. We can do improved integrity monitoring and anti-spoofing. 5G requirements. To get the full 5G promise, it will require tight synchronization. The network densification will bring challenges where we believe our receivers are a very good match. And then lastly, our solution, the ZF90 multiband GNSS receiver, has been specifically designed for 5G. And I think that's all. I think we can go to the questions.
Great. So thanks. First of all, thanks, Samuli, for this very interesting introduction into the topic. I'm sure a lot of you have questions, so let's jump to the interesting part of this to see what you guys have answered. So I will just pull up the first question from Mark. So could you explain the difference between spoofing, jamming and spoofing?
Okay, yeah, good question. Maybe I did not clarify this. So we spoke about the anti-jamming and anti-spoofing. So jamming basically means these are both kind of radio interference techniques. So in jamming, you are sending an interfering signal with the aim to block the receiver. So it's pure noise interfering signal that just in kind of denial of service that the receiver cannot operate anymore. Spoofing is a little bit more sophisticated. In this case, you would actually transmit a fake satellite signal. Here your intention is not to block the receiver, but rather you want the receiver to output something that it is not supposed to output. Receiver output the fake location so that it looks to be somewhere else where it in reality is. And quite often you would expect to see maybe these two together. Maybe if somebody's attacking you, he would start by jamming and then moving on to spoofing. I hope this clarifies the difference between the two.
Yeah, thank you, Samuli. So let's jump to the next one. Here's one from Ricardo. You mentioned jitter reduction. Could you please elaborate on that?
Oh, yes. Good question. So, yeah, we mentioned the jitter and then the function that to actually reduce the jitter even further. So, The device itself, the firmware inside the receiver, when it is calculating the time, it knows it solves it in a very accurate way. But then there is a hardware limitation due to the digital logic inside the receiver that we cannot really output the time pulse exactly where we want it to. We can only output at certain clock edges. And this leads to some small quantization error. This is the jitter that we say that the plus minus 4 nanosecond. And sometimes this is called the sawtooth effect. If you plot the output versus your reference clock, you can see the error goes in a sawtooth kind of fashion. However, the receiver inside the firmware knows actually what is this error, this sawtooth error, this quantization error. And we provide this as a software message, as a firmware message. So from the receiver, you get the hardware time pulse. But in addition to that, you also get a message which tells you exactly how many nanoseconds you should correct this pulse to get the exact time pulse output. And this is the jitter reduction. So you would need to read the message and apply it on top of the hardware signal that you get.
Super. Some go straight to the next one. We have so many great questions from you guys. So this comes from Hans. Do you see any difference in timing between the different constellations? So GPS, Galileo, GLONASS, or Beidou?
This is a bit political question. I need to be careful with my words. Yes, we see some difference if you run the receiver in a single constellation mode. Typically, GPS seems to be the one that is the best in the timing, probably because they have the longest track record. They have been doing this for decades already. Galileo and Baidu also quite good. GLONASS, I'm afraid, is not quite on the same level. However, our recommendation is to not use a single GNSS, but rather use a multi-GNSS. So in this case, you can take the benefit from all the systems and you get the better averaging of the timing, and also you get the better availability as you will have more satellites. So overall you would get the best performance by enabling all constellations.
Great. All right, so here's a question that came in quite early into the presentation from Atanu. GNSS time is synchronized to which universal time? Is it NIST time?
Okay, yeah. So there is actually no one GNSS time. So each of the systems have their own system time. So GPS has their own system time, which is maintained by the US Air Force in, is it Colorado somewhere, where they have their master control station. So they have their own clocks in the master control station, and these are then linked to the US national time from NIST. Or okay, anyways, the US national time. I'm not quite sure who is maintaining of the US national. But then the similar way, the Galileo system time is then linked to the European time, and in China, the Baidu system time, which is maintained by the Baidu constellation operator, this is then linked to the Chinese national laboratories time. So you need to be a little bit careful when you configure the receiver to actually which GNSS time you are using, and if you're using UTC time, then which UTC variant you are using. But all this can be configured within the receiver.
All right. So I am scrolling through. Let's take so let's take this from Shamir. What are the typical values for survey duration and accuracy?
Yeah, this is an excellent question. I would say it depends on what you are aiming for. If you are aiming for the highest accuracy, I would recommend to run the survey in for 24 hours, because as I explained, the ionospheric conditions will change over daytime and nighttime. By doing this over 24 hours, you would see the full cycle. But I understand in many applications, waiting for 24 hours might be a bit overkill. So in these cases, you might set a shorter time and then think about the accuracy, the position accuracy instead. And here you can use the, roughly the rule of thumb for each meter equaling 3 nanoseconds. So if you're happy with 3 nanoseconds, you could set the accuracy requirement to 1 meter, maybe 2 meter for 6 nanoseconds and so forth. And therefore, because the survey in any ways, it expects that both of the conditions are met. So even if you put the time to slightly shorter duration, it does not stop when the time is met until also the position accuracy is met.
This comes back again to the timing mode accuracy. So this is from Silvio. Samuli, do you mean that the timing mode accuracy is relevant only in static mode? How about the timing accuracy mentioned in the data sheet?
So the timing accuracy mentioned in the timing devices data sheet is obviously in the timing mode. Yes. So these are timing receivers, and the timing accuracy is in the timing mode.
Okay, great. So we only have around 3 more minutes, but we do have time for some more questions. So here is one from Marek. Can we control dominant timescale in multi-constellation mode?
Can we control dominant? This, I think, is maybe better answered by Teemu in the next
seminar.
I have a hunch, but I would need to verify from the documentation.
Yeah,
let's take it to demo to answer in the next call.
Yeah, let's save it for next 2 weeks. Okay, so we will, what time? Yeah, we have 3 more minutes. So let's jump. Here is quite a long one from Tim. Is the effect of the ionosphere can cause up to 20 nanosecond timing error? Would all identical receivers in any single geographic area show the same error? For example, would all PPS remain aligned across all nearby receivers without mitigation?
Yeah, this is a good question. So if you have the receivers in the same geographical area, obviously the sky above would be similar. So to some extent, this is true. Yes. Of course, you need to remember then that you would have to be receiving the same set of satellites, so that the direction where the signal is traveling through the ionosphere would also need to be the same.
Okay. So maybe we take one last question. Here's one from Alberto. What impact has a low-cost antenna on the accuracy of a timing receiver, fixed positions?
This is also a good question. So typically with the low-cost antenna, you are, well, it obviously it is not as good as a professional grade antenna. This is mostly due to the reflections you get from ground reflections, for example. The antenna tends to pick up more kind of reflected signals from various directions, and therefore it has a negative effect to the overall timing accuracy.
Thank you, Samuli. Thanks everyone for sending your questions. We're running towards the end here, and as mentioned, if we didn't get back to your question, we will send a written response to you in due time. So I will just run this through quickly. We have more webinars on the GNSS topic. You see them on our website if you go to ublox.com/webinars. But please don't forget our GNSS timing webinar part 2 on March 3, where you will learn how to master GNSS timing like a pro. And also next week, you can meet us at Embedded World. Excited to see you. Just come up, talk to the team. We would be happy to see you there. Yes, the webinar, the product page, here are some more resources to guide you further. If you have any questions, here are some of the email addresses or platforms you can reach out to. I thank everyone for watching today. I hope to see you again in 2 weeks, and I wish you a great day. Bye-bye.